to join us in prayer and to receive a word from my lovely wife, Pastor White, Paula White Cain. So now, just take a divine pause. Lift up your hands. Shout a praise. Rejoice in the Lord, always. Rejoice in the Lord, always. We call in your presence, oh God. Fall down in this place.
Good morning, City of
Destiny. Clap your hands, come on.
We want you to join us and let's give God all that we've got this morning. We exalt you, Heavenly Father. We come to dance in your presence and we thank you for this day. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive because you're alive in me. Your grace has come to rescue me. Your purpose.
Family, are we ready to worship?
Hallelujah.
I want to share a new song. It's the first time. I heard it on the radio and it moved me. Christ in me. Here we go. In this obsession with the things the world says makes us happy, can't see the slaves we are in all the searching, all the grasping. Like we deserve much more than all the blessing we're holding. So now I'm running free into an ocean of mercy. The things I once was chasing after. Throw off these heavy chains that I have let become my master. Yeah. So now I'm running free into an ocean of mercy. Makes us happy.
Lift up your hands.
We're going to shift this atmosphere. For the Bible declares in Psalms that we are to lift up our eyes into the hills, from which cometh our help. Because all of our help comes from the Lord, who makes heaven and earth. So whatever heavy burden you're having this morning, just release it. Give it unto the Lord, because he's the only one who cares for you. In the name of Jesus, we bless you, Lord. God, I look to you. I won't be overwhelmed. Give me vision to see things like you do. God, I look to you. You where my help comes from. Give me wisdom. You know just what to do. I will love you, Lord, my shield. And I will love you, Lord, my rock. Forever, all my days, I will love you, God. Speak to the Lord. Tell him all about your troubles. He's the only one who can bear them. In the name of Jesus, we bless you, Lord.
Wants to
Hallelujah. We bless you in this place. God, we look to you. You where our help comes from. Give us wisdom.
Yes.
You know just what to do.
Come on and just worship the Lord. There's such a sweet presence of His Spirit here right now. And Father, you do reign. We're so blessed to be able to worship you, to exalt your name, to extol you. For holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. There is none like you. We worship you. With every breath of my body, I give you all the praise, all the glory, all the honor. For you are worthy. You alone are worthy. We lift up you, Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you right now in this moment that we can be one with you. We thank you for your presence. Holy Spirit, just flood this place. Flood every home, every person that is watching right now. Do what only you can do, not by might and not by power, not by anything but your Spirit. In Jesus' mighty name. Such a sweet presence here, you know, and God in one moment can do what man cannot do for you. God can heal you, and God can restore you, and God can shift you, and God can give you His wisdom and His joy, and He is your rock. He is your foundation. It seems so much sweeter. There's such an open heaven, and I don't know if that is because a recognition of some of the freedoms that have been taken from us. I know one thing, we're in a new era. I know that we're in a new day. I know that we're battling as the church. If it's a remnant that's so hungry for God, but God is here for you. And I know right now in this sanctuary, I can feel the very tangible presence of an awesome, wonderful, loving, good God. That whatever you have need of, He's here for you, to love you, to give you wisdom, to give you strength, to give you His peace, to have a real relationship with you. I just feel like someone's watching right now and you might not have that relationship. The Bible says in Romans chapter 10, verse 9 and 10, that if you confess the Lord Jesus Christ with your mouth and believe in your heart that He is the Son of God, say, how do I know? Because that's the Holy Spirit right now just calling you. He's knocking on the door, and all He wants you to do is open the door and let Him in. And if you just pray, Father, I come to you in the name of Jesus. Forgive me for all my sin. I receive you as my Lord and my Savior. And we welcome you to the family of God. Right now, the Bible says that the angels of the Lord are rejoicing, that heaven throws a party. Now that's, people say, is it that simple? I say it really is, but that's the beginning. The easiest part is receiving Jesus Christ. The hardest part is walking it out for a long time. Because the moment that you say yes to God, there's an opposition that awakens against you, because the enemy hates what God loves. And God loves you so incredibly much. Amen. Well, it's good to be in the presence of God. Worship team, thank you so much. I'm so proud of you all. Demetrius, Shay, Minister John, Mar, Joy, thank you. Come on and let them know how much we love them and appreciate them. Yeah, Alex, turn my light back up like that. Keep it up like that. Thank you, guys. A few things, you can be seated. It is so good to see Miss Gloria. Sure do love you, appreciate you. You guys are moving everything. Elder Harold and Gloria, it was their 50th wedding anniversary yesterday. Elder Harold and Miss Gloria, we love you guys. I should just move out of the way and let you guys come. He's saying Miss Gloria. Come up and tell us what a testimony, what a life. You're such a personal encouragement to me. You're pillars in the body of Christ. And I know that no one can stand that strong with that much wisdom without having been tempered and gone through things. And though I don't know the fullness of your testimony, I know there has to be one there that God is faithful. He is faithful. 50 years. That's awesome. baby, that means you need to stay alive 44 more years, because we're going to make it. We're going to make it 50 years, all right? God can do it. John just looked at me like, you'd only be 114, baby. Come on. God is good. I really believe I have a word. It's a word that's really strong and heavy in my heart and in my spirit, and I'm praying for everyone. Just before we get into the word, we do want to continue, and we want to pray and lift up Pastor Todd and Anna. Anna, they were having a Christmas in July with their family yesterday and went ice skating. And Anna said, I thought I was 25 years old, you know, and so she fell and she broke her wrist. They took her to the emergency room last night, and she went into surgery this morning at 7 a.m. She's out of surgery, and we praise God that she is out. But let's pray right now. We love Pastor Todd and Anna. Father, we just believe in miracles, and we just thank you. And we thank you, Father, that you have been so involved from step one to right now. And we pray for Pastor Todd and for Anna. And we just ask right now for a supernatural healing, that you would expedite and accelerate her bones to fuse together, that there would be no complications. And we just thank you right now for every doctor and nurse and technician that attends to her. And we pray for every family member right now, that you would give them peace and you would wrap your arms of love around them. Isaiah 53 says, you were wounded for our transgression, bruised for our iniquity. The chastisement of our peace is upon you, and with your stripes we are healed. We pray for every family that is hurting right now, God, for every couple that is struggling, for every body that is sick right now. You're a God of miracles. You're a God of the supernatural. And though we're in this world, we're not of this world. We thank you that you hold fast to your covenant, and that according to Psalm 89, verse 34, you will not alter your covenant or that which has gone out of your lips. For you are a covenant-keeping God. Heaven and earth will pass away, but your word shall remain forever. So as we speak the word of freedom, we speak the word of healing, we speak the word of deliverance, we speak the word of love, and we speak the word that you would just pull together what the enemy is trying to divide and tear asunder, and that you would heal emotionally and spiritually and physically in every area of our lives in Jesus' mighty name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. We pray over one another, knowing that the power of prayer is so strong, and that when two of us agree is touching anything, that God hears it and answers it. It's so good to see you all. I love you guys. I love you. Thank you for being here. We love our internet church, and we pray you're staying safe and you're praying well. It's time to receive his tithe and your offering. Let me just go real quick to Malachi, and then I'm going to read your praise report, because I love encouraging you in the faith and just knowing what God is doing. Malachi, it's, you know, God really talks about giving from Genesis to Revelation. And it's an honor to give. We don't give to get, but we get to give. And I say that because, like so many teachings in the Word, they've been taken so out of context. But the reality is, every time you give to God, something supernatural happens. God multiplies that seed. And somehow, you know, I am an absolute believer in tithing. I actually, you know, I believe in tithe and offering. I believe that it all belongs to God, and God speaks to us as to what to give. He might tell some of us to give it all, to walk away from everything. There were in the Old Testament primarily five different types of offerings. And God just, he walks with you with your faith, and in I think everyone at some point in their life, they have to, in their Christian walk, you get past what I call the money test. And why is that? Because it's an issue of the heart. And it's not that God needs our money. The church does, of course. God uses it for being able to take care of things, to take care of the storehouse. But it's a deeper work, because what God wants to do is access your life. He really does. So if God says, here, I need you to fulfill this assignment, or I need you to move here, or I need you to minister to that person. And I think one of the hardest things to access in people is often finances. It's just one of the hardest things that we don't want to let go. We want to be in control. And I can tell you, when I first got saved, I struggled with even the concept of tithing. Like, how will this happen? You know, I can barely budget out living in my trailer, but I can also tell you that when I made a decision and a commitment to start to tithe, and that's where it started for me, just in tithing, all the days of my life, all God has taken care of me. I've lived in, you know, I can be like David where I go, I've been young and I'm getting older, but I've never seen the righteous forsaken nor his seed begging for bread. And I want you to know God is your source. And so tithe this a first tenth because you're honoring God, and that's what it's really about. And he says to his covenant people that they have gone away from ordinances, which are very holy, sacred things. And they're like, well, where? You know, we're keeping our ordinances. And he said, you've not kept mine ordinances in verse 7. And he said, return to me and I'll return to you, saith the Lord. And that's interesting because God always wants us to come to him. He says, you come to me and then I'll come to you. And they said, okay, well, where? Where do we need to return? And he said, will a man rob God? And I tell you often, and that's defraud. But it's like putting this lid on here because God's a giver. So God wants to pour out blessing. But as we don't obey the word of God or stay in covenant with him, he's like, I want to bless you, but you've put a lid on me. It's just like he said to Israel, you've limited the Holy One of Israel. So it's interesting that God, who is so loving and giving and can supply all of our needs, we have the ability to limit God. We have the ability to stop God from blessing us through many different ways, but through our disobedience. He said, yet you've robbed me. And they go, well, where? And he says, in tithes and offering. So he says, you're cursed with the curse, not because God curses you, because God doesn't. God is a good God. But what those two words mean, they're two separate Hebrew words. He means you've invoked demonic spirits. And so what happens in this, for you have robbed me, even this whole nation. So the nation suffered because the people who had covenant. Because when you're in covenant with God, it's different than when you're not. So he gives the answer, bring all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be meat in my house. And prove me, test me. It's one of the places God's like, test me. And see if I will not open you the windows of heaven and pour out blessing that there shall not be room enough to receive it. And I love this part. I will rebuke the devourer for your sake. Because that's the waster. That's the spirit of waster. And it's amazing because as a believer, it doesn't mean you won't go through things. But it is interesting. Like God will allow things like, you know, I say we see food. We see like so much food that will, I'll give you our latest statistics. We're literally, I think this week was another 380-something thousand pounds of food that we distributed, and just amazing what God's doing. And it's like he multiplies the fish and the loaves. I mean, he just makes sure that your cruise never lacks oil, your barrel never lacks wheat. It's just he causes over, and when I say overflow, not your every wish and whim. God makes sure that you have what you need for provision and purpose in your life. Whether it's your tires, I mean, I've had a place of faith where I used to not have gas money. I don't know if you've ever been there. And I would sit there and pray, like, God, just get me to church and get me back. And I'd be praying over it, and God, make this happen. And somehow, supernaturally, I never ran out of gas. I mean, or some, you know, someone I would, I mean, this is back in the old day, all right, guys, where we still had the pay phones, remember? And I'd go in the little thing, and I'd find change. I'd get me an extra 2 quarters, and it'd always be like, I'd find it, or in a vending machine. And it's like, I even to this day, I'll tell you something. If I ever see a penny or a nickel on the ground, I don't just walk by it. I always pick it up because I think if you do, you just don't respect money. You just waste it, right? And I'm like, hey, that's like 25 extra cents God just gave me. But you know what? That 25 extra cents helps me put extra gas in my car. I'm telling you. So I can't say how God, sometimes he's done it in big ways, but sometimes it's just all the little ways that add up. Or how God's kept me, like the way that I've traveled over my life, the way that I've done things. My body should have been broken down a long time ago, but he gave me supernatural energy and supernatural health. So, you know, I've never had any big doctor bills in my life. I've never had anything, and I'm not saying, it's just like God has ways of providing for us that sometimes not just like so obvious. Sometimes they're even taken for granted. Like that things just last in your life. And that's the spirit of waster that God is holding back. That it doesn't get to touch you. Amen. And there's so many good things that we need to be grateful to God. So let's get our covenant. If you're giving online, you can do so by going to City of Destiny. Oh, let me read a praise report. I love the praise reports. Courtney, and you can send your prayer requests and your praise reports to paulawhite.org. Are there, and we, that's the easiest way because it's just, it's process. It says, I sent in a prayer request asking for my friend to be released from prison during the COVID-19 crisis, home to his family. I thought this would never happen. The family has been affected greatly since he's been incarcerated. But on Friday, I received news that he was being released. I could not believe it, but I am so thankful for your prayers and feel so blessed and appreciative. Come on, our God is such a faithful God. And we read so many different praise reports. You've heard everything from healing to provision to salvation because we believe that prayer works. And so as you honor God, just remember, you too are going to have a praise report. So you can make your checks or however you do it here, guys. We keep our social distancing, and thank you for everyone. I just am so grateful for every volunteer. We bring it, or if you're going online, just go to cityofdestiny.us, or you go to paulawhite.org. Let's see, I don't have them all in front of me. Or you text the number. I know it's 45777-PWM, or they're putting a number up right now for COD. Or also, you can give by Cash App, or you can just mail it in at 505 East McCormick Road. But they'll do lower thirds right now, and they'll let you know how to give. Thank you so much. Father, I just pray over every giver. I pray that you would just multiply and bless their gift that they have given to you, that you would rebuke the devourer for their sake in Jesus' mighty name. And I thank you that they will always have provision. For Matthew 6:33 says, as we seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, all these things will be added unto us in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God is good. All right, guys. I'm going to try to get through this one. I've got to be honest, though. Let me give you the what we've done this week, all right? So food distribution, year to date, 3,121,820 pounds. That is a miracle. How great is our God? They have fed 450,679 family members just in our area. We're not talking about the work we do down on the border, everywhere else. But for this week, 377,000 pounds, 972 pounds of food distributed through the City of Destiny alone. That's almost 400,000 pounds of food. That's an absolute miracle. 115 local churches and ministries were resourced. It just keeps going on and on. 150 area churches. We continue with so many of our different partnerships: World Vision, City Serve, Convoy of Hope, Mercy Chefs, Cisco, Second Harvest Food Bank, Love and Life Foundation, Goss Foundation, Farmers to Family, and it just continues to go because God is a great God. And you go, well, why is that so important? Sometimes, Antoine, you can tell how when a person comes up, they need love. You know, right now, our suicide hotlines are up 800%. People are hurting right now. Food has become a real way of helping people in a tangible way feel the love of God. Amen? And know that. So I'm so proud of you all. Thank you. I cannot say thank you enough to every volunteer, to every person. Okay, I have a word. And I've been, I have a word. But I've got to tell you, there are times as a pastor, you want to preach a word that makes everyone feel really good, right? That's satisfying. But when something's burning so deep in your spirit with such conviction, I feel not only would I be irresponsible, but held accountable for that. And the church is in a real battle right now. We're in a real battle. And to ignore that would be to put our head in the sand and pretend. It's difficult for me watching and knowing and hearing and having knowledge of things and feeling like, where is the righteous indignation of the church? Now, I know that there's there. I know that it's not just, we're not just Elijah, I know that he's got 7,000 more. I believe there is a remnant. But we are fighting for the very heart and soul of God's church. And I want you to understand, God loves you tremendously. And people will say, well, he came for me. You'll hear my message today. The world is his harvest. That's true. But God didn't come for the world. He came for the church. The church is his bride. And you as a part of his church, he loves all people. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. But his ardent heart and desire is the bride of Christ. And I'm going to break that down so much more today. There is no institution in this earth like the blood-bought church. Not Apple, not Google, not government, not media, not Hollywood. There is no institution like the blood-bought church. And there is only one church, the Church of Jesus Christ. And when I say worldwide, it's been under attack for since its conception, but I think as Americans, and I'm speaking specifically to a nation here, as we talk about rebuilding a nation, rebuilding cities, rebuilding families, and how we've been studying, and I've been stuck in Ezra. Just time after time, there's so many things happening so fast that I don't even know if we realize everything. I talk about Chief Justice Roberts and the ruling in California, our brothers and sisters struggling in California. They cannot sing, cannot chant, cannot recite mass, cannot have church. Well, a ruling just came down. Same with Nevada. Less now, you can go into a casino and have thousands of people in a casino, but you cannot have more than 50 people in a church. When you understand what that is, it's discrimination, and no one's screaming out. Well, I can't say no one, but there aren't the voices that are screaming out, you have power. You have power to do something. You have power in prayer. That's your most powerful weapon. You have power in action. Our faith without works is dead. And so if we don't stand for the church, God's love and God's heart, there is no hope for society. To think that your voice, that the enemy does not want the voice of pastors and preachers shut down, and we'll deal with this deeply. Pastors and preachers' voice have been compromised for a long time. I can keep on going. I can go into so many different things, whether it's Pennsylvania just passing that binary, you don't have to put your male or female, you can put your X on a driver's license now. I can talk about the religious freedoms being taken away so quickly from all people of faith. I can talk about how the Radical Teachers Union of Los Angeles said that they would elect Biden, and I'm not saying this for political reason, but that they would not have any private schools, which means that all Christian schools would be shut down. I can just continue to go, and what I'm saying is, may your eyes be open. May our eyes be open to fight for what God loves, to fight for the church. I'm not talking about a world system. I'm talking about a blood-bought church. May our eyes be open that you align yourself with God. God unfortunately has to use in a sin-stricken world that is in a fallen state, imperfect systems for his will and his plan to go forth, because that's the condition of this world until the return of Jesus. Amen? Until there is a new world, until there is this heaven and earth pass away. But there will never be a perfect system. There is no perfect institution. There is the blood-bought Church of Jesus Christ. And we are not perfect people, amen? There is no perfect system. But it is the only legal entity that has the ability to bring forth change. And so what I preach today, may it be by the Spirit of God that every word is ordained by God. May the Holy Spirit prick your heart and remove every scale, because the hope for your children's salvation, the hope for your marriage, the hope for your legacy and lineage, the hope for your healing, the hope for your deliverance, the hope for everything in your life is the Lord Jesus Christ. It is the Lord, and He is the head of the church in which His body acts and moves and speaks through. It is the church that God moves through to touch and transform this world. So I personally am praying and believing that God is bringing a great awakening and a great revival to bring forth the Reformation. You know, never in my life would I have thought 20-something years ago, 30 years ago, you know, like many of you, have studied the Word of God all my life, every day, apply myself to the Word of God. But there are things that we live today that I honestly, 20 years ago, probably would never have thought I would see in my lifetime. I would see in my lifetime. And it's so fast and it's so rapid that we just have to have our eyes open spiritually. I'm not even asking you to get intellectually informed on everything, though it would be good, because information helps bring transformation. But I am asking you to pray. I'm asking you to hear by the voice of God. I'm asking you to be led by the Spirit of God. Because we have tried to make the gospel individual, almost self-help, to make us better. Okay, that's not what the gospel is for. Now, those are benefits of the gospel. It's benefits of the gospel. It helps us. But God has a bigger picture. Can I talk to you about it today? Because we're moving over to Ezra chapter 8 today, all right? So we've been talking about, where are the wall builders? We know 2 Chronicles 7:14 that Solomon has just built the temple. He's having a conversation with God. And God says, there'll be a day where there's no rain. There'll be a day where I, God, will send a plague. And then He says, if my people, which are called by my name, will humble themselves, right? And pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways. So He's not talking to the world. He's talking to who? The church, those who He's in covenant with. He said, then will I hear from heaven. Then will I forgive their sin and I will heal their land. We've looked at Nehemiah. I won't go into the scriptures, but Nehemiah chapter 1, we're going to get over to Nehemiah because that's where I intended to start, but I've been stuck in Ezra. We've got two more chapters, all right? And we've talked so much history through this, so please go back and get it all because you really need to hear the fullness of it. So what we've seen is, you know, when we get to Nehemiah, Nehemiah will do in 52 days the Jews from the time of Zerubbabel to Ezra up to Nehemiah, because Nehemiah will restore the city of Jerusalem, which is the city of peace, right, and safety and protection, and then the land of Judah. So the land will be restored. So for a nation to be restored, you have to have a city restored. For a city to be restored, you had to have the temple restored. The church had to be restored. So there were several things that took place because God's people were in captivity. Why were they in captivity? Because they had disobeyed God. They'd made everything else an idol. We've talked a lot about that, that anytime you put something before God, whether it's your spouse or your children or your bank account or your job, your title, it becomes an idol in our life. And so God in His love and grace and mercy moves on this King Cyrus, and He gives three proclamations, and this time a remnant comes out of captivity. A remnant. And that's important. We've talked a lot about the remnant. So by the time that Nehemiah rises up and does in 52 days, this process, it's originally one script, right? And right sandwiched between Ezra and Nehemiah, you have Esther. So a lot of times we'll take things out of context, like we've been raised up for such a time as this, but you've got to understand the whole context of what God is doing here. And it's almost as if we're living it out. It's the pattern of how we see restoration, which brings forth a reformation. I'll make that real clear so you understand truly what we're talking about today. And so we get there in verse 3, Nehemiah says, well, how is God's people and how is God's place? Always two of the most important questions you'll ever ask. How is God's people? How is God's place? He says, not so good. The remnant that are left, they're in captivity, and they're in a province that is in great affliction and reproach. The walls are broken down, right? And the gates are burned with fire, all of them except for one gate, which was the word gate. And we'll get into those gates, what those 12 gates represent, which meant that the joints were broken because the walls could not be held. So when the joints are broken, Ephesians refers to the body as the joints that supply one another. So all of this is going to God's church, going to God's house. You with me? And then we found and discovered three main themes, right? Repentance, which is not just I'm sorry, but it's I changed my mind, I changed my direction, I go back to a path that has been traversed. Prayer and fasting. So I always remind you of this, and I'm going to go back to this scripture because I really believe it for now, that God always uses his church as the tool to bring healing to the nations. And Isaiah chapter 61 says, then will they rebuild the ancient ruins. That's the truth. That's the word of God. They will rebuild the ancient ruins. They will erase at the former devastations. They will repair the ruined cities and the desolation of many generations. So I believe right now, God, give us by your spirit and by your grace and mercy to repair the ancient truths, to bring back the word of God in our churches, in our homes, in our families, in our communities, in our schools, come on, in our nation. I'm going to stick on the word. There's so much fighting that. There's so much happening so fast. I could start right now and just say, go check it out yourself. Check out this tweet. Check out this. Check out that. Because there is such an antichrist agenda to take away everything that is the truth of God's word. So may God use you to repair the ancient truths. May God use you, come on, to repair the ruined cities, the desolation of generations, the desolation, the destruction of generations. As we studied chapter 1 through 7 in Ezra, we looked at where are the wall builders. Today we're going to talk about and move on to chapter 8, which is who are you joined to? Because this is what's going to be so crucial, because after he repairs the word, so remember there were several things, right? In order to rebuild the city, the nation, they had to, number one, restore the altar. We've gone through all this. Repair the altar. Then they had to restore the temple. Then they had to bring back the feast, God's divine appointments. Then they had to restore worship, right? Then they had to restore the word of God, which is where we've left off. When the word was restored, I left you with what happened when to those who did not restore to the word. Remember death and the things that happened, the loss of things, and what happened to the people who did restore the word of God. And then we left off with the 9 things that happened, the requests that were granted to Ezra because of restoration of the word. So when the word was restored, then sanctification came, a separation for reformation. Now, right after that, in chapter 8, he's going to get into what you'll call the registry. So he had to register those who were with him. This is important because who is with you, all right, is absolutely important. And then he'll go into, and it's possible that it was just males, because there's, I'll talk to you probably about that much more next week. But then we'll go into, because there's a lot of focus on the male in this, and I'll get into it today. But then we'll go into, then there's almost this awakening in 9 and 10, because there's an intermingling of unholy seed and holy seed. And we'll get to that, because that's very important. So today, we're going to focus on who are you joined to, all right? And there's some things that I believe that will be personally applicable, that'll help you in your personal walk, but I'm really addressing the church at large. Is that good? Is that good? So we caught up on that? All right, so God has a purpose. That was pretty quick, guys, because you know I'm usually about 40 minutes in doing that. That was a pretty quick summary. Because one of the hardest things is continuing to move, Miguel, in this way that God is showing you. So God's purpose is to restore that which has been lost and to reconstruct that which has been broken down. So as we see even in our own nation, ancient truths, as we see devastated city, desolation of generations. There's a huge gap between boomers and what do we call it now? What do we call the younger ones? Wires, whatever they are. Okay, there's a huge gap between thought, thinking, perception. And though it seems like it happened overnight, this has not been an overnight thing. I mean, I've had a problem even for, you know, I'm a pretty, like, untraditional minister, let's put it that way. I'd be pretty untraditional. And I'm not, you know, hung up on all the legalistic things of the word or of, you know, that can happen through religion. But I would have problems like as my grandchildren were born and I try to put on a cartoon or something. I'm like, man, every cartoon I put on, they kill off the father or there's some kind of sorcery or there's some kind of, and I didn't want that indoctrinated into them. I didn't want that just that every time, you know, so there was a couple that I could watch and those couples they tried to kill off. Like Paw Patrol was one of the few things that was like a cute little cartoon that I didn't have to worry about them killing off the father or having some kind of witchcraft or sorcery or anything else. And so down to the smallest of ways into much more blatant ways, much more blatant, that we have been fighting against really hard in the last 2 years. And so God wants to restore the truths that have been lost, the devastated cities, are you with me? The desolated cities and the devastated generations and that which is broken down. In Nehemiah even, it's really visible because that which looks like rubbish and ruins or when Zerubbabel came out, that which looks like rubbish and ruins, I believe will be restored. So even as we see things that look, I mean, in the natural, like rubbish and ruins will be restored and repaired to bring both restoration and reformation. We'll get to that because reformation does not have to do with building another form. It has to do with reestablishing the original, the intention of God. It is a realignment and adjustment to God's original intention, both for your life and for His church. So if you've ever had like a really bad back problem, maybe you go to get a little adjustment at your chiropractor or something. But if you get a really bad back problem, you have to go in for surgery, right? If you get, you know, you're acting like you don't know, or if you've got something that's really out of, so there's some surgery that has to be done for the church. There's some surgery because for reformation, it is a realignment. It's not just a chiropractor right now. It needs a specialist surgeon to go in for complete realignment to God's original intention for both your life and His church. Now, His Word, which is why we spent so many weeks talking about the reestablishment of the Word, because the first conclusion you have to come to is the Word of God is the infallible truth, that is truth. Amen? And we receive it as such. It's perfect. It's flawless. So God will always have a people who believe their God and possess their possessions. God will always have a remnant. God will not be in trouble. God will always raise up a people, whether it's a Joseph that's gone through a process, whether it's a David who seems like an unlikely candidate, whether it's a Rahab, whether it's, we just keep going on, whether it's an Esther or a Zerubbabel or an Ezra. God will always have a people. And I believe you are a people of God called for such a time as this. I believe that you wouldn't be here, you wouldn't be watching, if there's not a hunger and a pulling in your heart, a stirring in your heart. So I pray today that our eyes are enlightening, that you understand how much of a world changer, that in this earthen vessel, there is a deposit of wealth. It's not this vessel, it is what is in me. It is the life of Christ. It is the same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead that now dwells on the inside of me. So what we see is we have discovered that reformation comes through restoration. So restoration means to bring back to the original state. It literally means to back again. So it starts with a remnant. Just in case you missed it, a remnant is that which is left. A remnant is that which remains. It is a residue, that which is left after the part is recovered, one who escapes. So a remnant is a survivor. A remnant is like the last part of the fabric on the bolt. So a remnant is just remnant people are survivors. So you hear stuff like a Joseph's company. You hear stuff like a remnant people, right? The Bible refers to as a remnant. That's that which is left. So when you look at, am I a remnant person? You know who you are, right, Moses? Because you shouldn't have made it down the Nile. Like that you should have not made it and just happened to land at Pharaoh's, right? As if that's just coincidental and God wasn't protecting you. You can look at your own life and say, there's no way. Other people don't know all of your testimony, but you know it. That there's no way you should have made it, but God protected you. God covered you by a grace. God kept you by his power, by his spirit, because God has an assignment for you. God has a purpose for you, because the reality is the storm should have taken you out, but you're part of a remnant. You have a purpose. You have an intention. You have a job to do for Jesus. Remnant people are real people that have been through things that they saw others being taken out by, but they survived it. You're still here for a reason. You're still standing for a purpose. God still has more for you to do. And if that more is in your prayer closet, or that more is on a worldwide stage with a bullhorn and a target right on you, God has more for you to do, because God loves his church. God has a plan. That plan is always working, and I believe that you are part of the plan. A remnant people realize, if it had not been for the grace and the mercy of the Lord, I would not be here. A remnant people realize, when I say stuff like this, people just kind of look at me like a deer in headlights. When I say the greatest blessing in my life is that God loved me enough to reduce me to Christ, because I'm in a position now that might feel hardened to some people, but things that would just scare the living daylights out of people. It's like another day of waking up. It's a constant part of my life, because God had to strip me. Literally, I say God had to strip me of everything so that there wouldn't be attachments in my life. And what I mean by that I could move freely in obedience to God. That I love people. But I know I love my husband. I love my children. I love you. But my attachment is to God. And out of that attachment, my overflow goes to people. So my attachment is not first to you. I'm not afraid of losing City of Destiny. I'm not afraid, because if I do, God will just raise something else up. I'm not afraid of losing a friend or a person. I'm not afraid of losing something. I'm not trying to hold on so tight and control. There have been times in my life I have been, but God just allowed everything that I tried to hold so tight to that was just squeezed, dried out. And as crazy as it sounds, it is the greatest blessing, because I know that in him I live and I move and I have my being. I know that God is truly my source. I know that the only way that there is breath in my body today, that there is any testimony and evidence of God in my life, is because he is a good God. He is a loving God. He is a faithful God. And so you realize, had it not been for the Lord, come on, whenever God is going to build or do anything great, he always leaves a remnant in place. So there is a remnant, come on, there will always be. And some of you are looking at what is left over in your life, and you're thinking, how can anything great come out of this? It's so little. You've gone through devastation. You've gone through the loss of a loved one, the deaths of somebody. You've gone through divorce. You've gone through disease. You've gone through loss of friends, loss of family, rejection. You're in good company. Come on. You're in good company, because Jesus, who made himself of no reputation, who lost so much, his very life, only to for what? For the birthing of the church, the bride of Christ, for the gain of God's intention and his purpose and his plan. So when we are attached to things and people, and I'm not saying that, you know, you're going to lose everything and every person in your life. That's not what I'm saying. But I'm saying if we're not willing, That's what he says. If we love our father and our mother more, or we love our spouse or our children more, if we're not willing to lose everything, then we've made that thing our God instead of making God our God. Are you hearing what I'm saying? So God's not about taking away from you. That contradicts so much of his teaching. But what he's saying is, we know how subtle the serpent is. We know how he gets in. So it's saying that God has to be God in our life, and there is none other but God. Are you with me on this? Because we're going somewhere. So when you look sometimes at the little that you have left, God likes getting you to a shrinking place. And when you look at the little that is left, when we look at the little that we have to work with, right? When you look at the little, maybe that is left in the economy or your money or your energy, and you're thinking, what can be done with this? Here's God's word to you individually and corporately. Zechariah 4:10, he who despises the day of small things, men will rejoice when they see the plumb line in the hand of Zerubbabel. So he says, don't despise those small beginnings, because men will rejoice when they see the plumb line in the hand of Zerubbabel. I've been teaching you this whole thing the whole time. Zerubbabel came back with just a few, a remnant. But he's saying men are going to rejoice when they see what's in the plumb line of just the hand of Zerubbabel. See, there's a plumb line in the little that is left in your hand. There's a plumb line in the remnant that is left in America. Come on, there's a plumb line in the remnant that is left. There is a plumb line, I'm telling you. So God loves to start with small. What looks like a little, God will turn into a whole lot. It's the shrinking process of God to get to a remnant. So God will take what is left and he will restore. So to restore means to build again. It means to repair. It means to renew. The original etymology means back again. So there are often people that think you'll never come back. You'll never make it back. They think right now that the church is over with, but I'm going to tell you, the church will rise stronger, and true revival, it has to come, because the world, the knowledge of the glory of the knowledge of the Lord must cover the earth as the seas cover the water, or the water covers the sea, according to Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 14. So God will raise up a people of boldness, a people who will not compromise, a people with the fear of the Lord, a people that walk in righteousness, that will be back again. I'm telling you, you didn't think you would make it out of that mess, but tell the enemy, don't throw your party just yet. You messed up. Come on. Don't bring out everything just yet. Because when I fall, not if I fall, when I fall, I will arise again. Come on. I will come back again. God is not through with your life right now. God's going to use you mightily. He's going to use you greatly. Back again. Somebody just needs to tell themselves, back again. It's not over yet. Why? Because the life that God put you in is larger than the one that you've been living. God has a big plan, and that plan is for his church. And God wants to use you. God uses, what I say, little people to do great big things for the kingdom of God. You are part of something that is bigger than yourself. And the problem, it's hard for me not to focus on problem, all right? I'm going to get there. The problem is the church has, like I said, become so self-ambitious that we miss the centrality, and that's why I taught so much of making it Christo-centered, Christ-centered, because if it's not about Christ, it's not about the church. Because it's not all about us. It's about Christ. And if you are in Christ, you can't help but to have a life that is full of goodness. To have a life that even if you're being stoned, Stephen, the glory of God is coming out of you. Come on, no matter what you're going through, there's no way, even if you're in prison, Paul and Silas, you're singing praises at the midnight hour. Because no matter what somebody does to you, they can't take who Christ is in you. You're not ruled by outside stimuli and circumstance, but you're ruled by the Spirit of Christ. So as part of a remnant people, you are an overcomer. That means you are a family of sons in the image of Christ. And I believe returning to Zion, a people and a place in Christ, to lead God's kingdom and people into restoration of all things. So God begins to integrate your testimony into a family of believers, in which means you had to go through what you went through. I'm not saying all God sent, but all God used. That what the enemy meant for bad, according to Romans 8:28, God will use for the good. Not for everyone that everybody likes to quote it, but for those who love God, who are the called according to His purpose, His intention. So by releasing your individuality, this is important, into something that is bigger than you while maintaining your uniqueness, then your life gets enlarged because now you recognize you are a member of the bride. You are part of the body. You are an important, unique part, that you play a role in the plan of God at this very moment, that time is for the purposes which are under heaven, that purpose is parenthetical, that you are sent into a time, raised up for such a time as this, with a unique gifting, a unique calling, a unique purpose, and a contribution as a remnant person to the plan of God. Are you with me? Because I'm just trying to get my people with me right now, all right? So I know you've had some success by your own efforts, but this next level of success is going to require a totally different style, because what brought you to this point will not be enough to move you forward. I'm telling you right now, what brought you, because you are going to see some. I believe, all right? If I'm wrong in 4 years, if I was Old Testament, you could stone me, but you can't in the New Testament, all right? But in the next several years, what I believe, you are going to see some dark days. I wish I could say everything's going to be bright, but the darker it gets in the world, the brighter the true church of Christ will shine. The brighter the light of God of the true church will shine. So what brought you to the point that you are will not be enough. You can't survive off of yesterday's manna. You need fresh manna. You need a word from God now. You need a fresh praise now. You need to hear a clarion call now. You need, may your ears be open and your eyes be open that you may see. You need the scales removed that you see now. Not just what you lived off from 20 years ago. Thank God, because those testimonies help bring you to the point you are. They're markers, they're memorials. But God will release fresh manna. Come on, God will when there is famine, remember they were living off dove's dung and they were living off of what? Come on, they were living off of dove's dung and asses' head. So they were living off the wisdom of man, which is nothing. And they were living off of where the Holy Spirit had left. So they were in a famine. And what did God say? Tomorrow by this time, there'll be fine flour. That is a process miracle of wheat. And wheat always represents the church and the manna, the word of God. Let's keep going. So real power doesn't come from knowledge. It doesn't. It comes from God. Real power comes by His Spirit. And it comes not just from knowledge, but by the Spirit of God. It comes through the wisdom of God. And the wisdom of God starts with the fear of the Lord. For the fear of the Lord is what will favor comes by the fear of the Lord. And the fear of the Lord comes by the wisdom of God. And to depart from, and understanding comes by departing from evil. Now that's important because you have to depart from evil. So that means that part of your power doesn't only come by the wisdom, the fear of the Lord, but also by your networks, because you've got to depart that which is evil. So God is expanding you through the expansion which will come through the people, because God works through a people, not just a person. And that happens through unity. All right, now I'm going to go somewhere, because when God moves, He moves. The one of the reasons that this has been like such a sweet spot for me ministering now is because there's no disunity. I'm not fighting. There's no resistance. There is such a difference preaching in the sanctuary, and I block anything right now from entering in that would not be in one mind, one heart, one accord. There is such a unity. I would rather have such a small handful. There are one mind, one accord, one heart moving for God than anything that would resist that. So I'm telling you that God's expanding us, and that expansion will come through unity, being unified. Now, contemporary Christianity, I'm going to get into some things. You ready? Buckle in, because contemporary Christianity looks on the church. Let me give an example here. Looks on the church, like in Corinth. I'm going to use the Corinth church as an example. And today, like contemporary Christianity would look on a church like Corinth, which had a lot of mess, trust me, with unjustifiable smugness. They would look on it with their nose down on it. Now, rightfully so, they had a lot of personal issues. Had just gotten saved. Paul was always trying to correct them. They had sexual sins. They had, you know, eating and gluttonous. And I mean, you don't even want me to get into all the details of that. We would criticize their carnality. That's part of the problem of when people are looking at other people in leadership or certain things. They are criticizing them and looking down upon them. They're also being backed into corners right now, right? They're looking down at them with their smugness and how God would never use that. Listen, never did I ever. Listen, I've been called about everything. Apparently, I've slept with everybody under the sun. I mean, I'm a prosperity preacher. You know, I just take everybody's money. But never until the last battles of my last few years of life was I called a heretic. I mean, I was never called a heretic, right? That I actually had to go on CNN. Come on, and defend myself that I believed in God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Anyone, which tells me that those people that would ever say anything about you or me never listened to us. Because you can't hear me for more than 10 seconds and me not always talking about God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. About the deity, about the Trinity, about Christ. So we would criticize the carnality. Can you imagine what Paul would have to say to the church today? Because we look at a church like Corinth, I'm giving you a comparison, and we would say, oh, how dare them. They were just so, here they were having orgies and they were getting drunk, which they were, you know, they were doing this and they were doing that. And we would criticize all of their personal sins and all of their unsanctification. But could you imagine if Paul was writing to the church today, writing to the church in America today, writing to the church, and I keep putting many places today, he would be outraged, because what he was mostly outraged was he recognized this process that they would have to go through, just like you and I have to go through, of going from glory to glory in our personal sanctification. He would be outraged. And what would he be most outraged by? By their divisions. Listen to what Paul had to say when he wrote to the church in Corinthian, who were only divided four ways. Only four ways. We're divided a whole lot more than four ways, which is why the church is so weak, which is why, because the church, come on, we don't even know what's really the church or what's not. Half the people, those of us who are spiritual, can understand because it's in alignment with the Word of God. Because you cannot contradict the Word of God. That is a spirit of Antichrist, and you cannot operate with the spirit of Antichrist and say you're the blood-bought church of Jesus Christ. Now, I'm going to tick some people off if I keep going deeper, because a lot of things label themselves, but you can look right, act right, talk right, and not be right. Be no part of it, because he will say, depart from me, you worker of iniquity, I never even knew you. Because God honors his word and he honors his name. And there are a lot of people that invoke the name and invoke the word, but they have no part at all to do. They have no real relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. 1 Corinthians 1:10-13, now I beseech you, which is a word like, hey, I beseech you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you all speak the same thing. Let's just start there, Luz, that you all speak the same thing. So right now, turn it on. Just turn on your top 10 preachers. They're nowhere near speaking the same thing. But do you think that the Holy Spirit is schizophrenic? Remember, I said one of the signs of a move of God is that a word, a now revelation word of God, will come forth where many different voices are speaking the same thing. When God is really moving to restore, to revive, to renew, to reform, God is not speaking where people are like schizophrenic and there's all these different sects. It will all be a beautiful myriad spoken in different ways and different languages to bring forth the same edification and the same, when I say word, the same end result. All right, end result. So watch, they all speak the same thing, and that there be no divisions among you. So what does he say? I'm beseeching you to speak the same thing, to speak the same thing, and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment. For it hath been declared unto me of you, my brother, I love Paul, by them which are of the house of Chloe, that there are contentions among you. Now this I say, that every one of you saith, well, I am of Paul, and I am of Apollos, and I am of Cephas, and I of Christ. Is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Or are you being baptized in the name of Paul? He said, I'm just a servant. Was I crucified and raised from the dead? No, Christ was. Everything comes back to the supremacy of Christ, to the edification of Christ, which builds the body up in the edification of love. Oh, I'm going to keep on going. Stay with me. He later continues in 1 Corinthians 3:3, for you are yet carnal. Now, what did we study last? That when you are carnal, it brings forth death, Romans chapter 8. But when you are spiritual, it brings forth life and peace. So he says, you are yet carnal, which means it's going to bring forth death. But if you are spiritual, it's going to bring forth life and peace. He says, you are yet carnal, for where there is among you envying and strife and divisions, are you not carnal and walk as men? He then goes on and he challenges the church. You would think that that'd be enough. But he says in 1 Corinthians 3:16 through 17, and we always like to use this very much out of context. He says, know ye not that you are the temple of God and that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you? And we all get excited. I'm the temple of God. And the Spirit, naos, right? Which means both a physical temple and a spiritual temple. You are the naos. You're the N-A-O. Is it U-S or N-A-O-S? Whichever it is. And you're the nos. However you'd say it. Ask Dr. Paul. All right, naos. All right, nos. So tell me which one. You are the temple and you are the spiritual temple. No, you not that you are the temple of God and that the Spirit of God dwells, lodges in you. If any man, ready, defiles the temple or the temple, him shall God destroy. For the temple, both physical and the temple of God, is holy, which temple you are. So we are the temple of God, both physical building and temple spiritual. Made up, you ready? Our churches, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 22. Our churches, like the stones of the temple, are to be laid side by side, building us together into a dwelling of God by the Spirit. You didn't hear me. Our temples, ready? Let me go. Our churches, like the stones of the temple, are to be laid side by side, building together into the dwelling of God in the Spirit. Do you know? Come on, guys. There are people here that have been sons and daughters that have gone and started their own church that I haven't heard from years. I haven't heard from the day they started the church. I haven't heard from pastors that are right around here that I've reached out to. Do you know how many stones are not laid side by side, building the temple, building the house, building the temple? If food brings us together, praise God, keep giving me food, God, because I will give it out to as many churches to build the temple, to lay the stones side by side. If it takes money that I can pay off your church, give me money, God, because whatever it takes to build the temple side by side and lay them side by side, if it takes love, whatever it takes, God, let me be a builder of your house, which is not just the city of destiny. I will tell you how far off we are, because most people in their pulpits will preach against other preachers or preach against other churches instead of preaching against, not so much against, but instead of preaching for what God is for. are dealing with the sins of the world. Oh, come on, I'm going to keep on going. So our churches are these stones laid side by side, building us together. I'm not just talking to us. Listen, this should be the simplest thing, that we're in one mind, one heart, one accord. But the temples, the churches, should be side by side. Let me just break it down, guys. I am real challenged right now with society, because I cannot, in my good conscience, stand with certain things. I'm the type of person, I pull my money out of stuff. I don't have billions of dollars. I don't have, like, but I have enough pocket change. I don't care if I had $10. I'll pull my money out of something that I do not believe in and I will not support. I will not buy certain stocks. There are certain places I will not go. There are certain places I won't go because of what they do, because of what they support. I won't do it because I will align myself with a spirit that is antichrist, that is totally against that which is of Christ. Sorry, not going to do it. Not going to support things that support Planned Parenthood. Not going to support terrorist organizations. Now, y'all are getting real quiet on me right now. And there's a difference between movements and organizations. And it's important. So, the Georgetown in 2016 quantified the body of Christ on a socioeconomic level. They wrote a book about me years ago called Holy Mavericks, of being one of the most influencers to bring forth socioeconomic, that America is still a religious nation. So they quantified us at the lowest quantification per year. The lowest, not talking about our personal income as people and as families, just what we do as churches, as Christians, at $1.2 trillion. Or it's $1.7, I'm sorry, $1 trillion. Now, with personal income, it'd be $4.3. Let me put that in perspective. In 2016, that was bigger than the top 10 tech companies, bigger than Apple, bigger than Google, and we think we don't have power. You know what we don't have? Unity, because we have power. So all we would need to do is, let us start our own banks. Let us start our own credit unions. Let us start our own schools. Let us start our own curriculums. They want to take everything away from you anyway. They're going to shut it down anyway. Let us start. My gosh, don't get me started. I'd start our own political party. Like I would start everything based on the word of God, because I believe his word. And a world system is going to continue to take your freedom. But Christ came to set you free. You have to know, Moses, what you're being trained by, to be used for, to bring God's people into. Because God always wanted his people to have a place and to be a people in Christ. Are you with me? So he says that they're laid side by side. The problem with the church is not that we don't have the ability, it's that we refuse to walk out in God's word. It's that we refuse to come together, united, to really bring forth true transformation. Paul went on to issue a warning. You ready? We might as well get the warning. I'm not going to get far through this. To the Corinthians, which every Christian should heed today. He said, if any man destroys the temple of God, him will God destroy. For the temple of God is holy. That was verse 17. So we attempt to use this verse to condemn personal things like sexual sins and smoking and drinking and all those other things, which have personal consequences to us, don't they? They do. They have personal consequences to us. But Abraham, did you lie about Sarah being your wife for 25 years and still become the father of many nations? But David, did you have a woman problem? Did he ever? And did you never get personal fulfillment? Because you could never get, he had such rejection in his life that he would run into the arms of a madman like Saul. He wanted Michael's love that he almost gave up the entire kingdom because he went back because she'd been given to another woman when he was out fighting for 17 years. And he goes back and he like wants her so bad. And she's just the sad seed of a failed father anyway. But he wants it so bad because he never had it. And he had so many personal issues. But does he fulfill all the will of God? Read the book in Acts. He does. But there are personal consequences in his life. So you can fulfill the will of God and still not have the fullness of satisfaction. That's why I'm saying the gospel does have individual benefits for you. But at the same time, the gospel has a greater, greater thing, and that is for his church. Are you with me right here? Because we've attempted to use this scripture in context of saying something to condemn certain things on an individual basis. But this is bigger than that, because Paul was speaking in more than just the context of excess sins of pleasure. He is speaking of destroying the unity of the temple. So when you break this down, he's talking about those who destroyed the unity in the church. He's speaking to the church and saying, those who destroy the unity in the church shall God destroy. You don't even want me to get into the etymology of destroy. Go home and look it up for yourself. The apostle warned that if any man destroys, and it was through jealousy and sectarianism, which means faction, pulling away, that God would destroy. The context speaks plainly in regard to the division of the church. Paul summarizes his thought by saying this in 1 Corinthians 3:21. So then let no one boast in men. When pure Christianity degenerates into divided camps of our own ambitions, of our own desire, of our own will, of our own wants, it literally destroys the harmony, the power, and the blessing of the temple of God and the temple of God. When you begin to see miracles, power is because there's unity. When you begin to see commanded blessing, because there's unity. You see it in a couple. You see it in a family. You see it in an individual church. You'll see it in the body of Christ. The individual who brings or supports such carnal divisions in the church has positioned himself to be judged by God. I told you it wouldn't be the easiest word I've ever preached, but it's a necessary word. Because you aren't to listen to everyone. Seriously. You'd be listening over here and listening over there. You're to be led by the Spirit of God. Dabbling in a little this, dabbling in a little that. Be led by the Spirit of God. The temple of God is holy. Our unity together is holy. Our love for one another is holy. For the Father himself dwells in the resting place of caring attitudes and loving relationships. See, God is a God of order, and he'll dwell in unity. He will not dwell in ruins. So watch what I'm saying here. Because he's a God of love, he'll work with us to rebuild, but he will not sanction our fallen condition with power. You've often heard me say there's a difference between divine acceptance and divine endorsement. The finished work of Jesus Christ gave us divine acceptance. You're accepted just the way you are, but you're not endorsed just the way you are. God's endorsement comes through our obedience to his word. I wouldn't give Asher right now an AK. I wouldn't give Asher anything. I wouldn't even get Asher a play gun right now, right? I wouldn't hand her over an AR-15 and say, here, have your way. Well, God's not going to give us as immature believers, which an AR-15 would be nothing. Shotgun would be nothing. You understand what I'm saying, the metaphor I'm using compared to the power of God? So God's power comes with our maturity, our obedience, Victor. Because he's a God of love, he works to rebuild. And this is important, because when I say there's a difference between God's divine acceptance and God's divine endorsement, he will not lend credibility to our disorder. So like Nehemiah, Paul also mourned when he saw the ruined condition of the church of Corinth. He said in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 20 and 21, "For I am afraid that perhaps there may be strife, jealousy, angry tempers, disputes, slanders, gossip, arrogance, disturbances. I am afraid that when I come again, my God may humiliate, maybe for you, and I may mourn over many of those who have sinned." So we should be in a state of mourning concerning the condition of the Father's house. Paul said, "I mourn because I'm afraid when I come back, I'm going to find you in the same state of carnality. I'm going to sign you in the same condition of disputing. Well, we do it this way, and I have this way, and this, and I'm more concerned about how I build my mailing list or my membership, or instead of laying brick by brick, stone by stone, to build the temple, the church of Jesus Christ." In fact, it should grieve us so much that there is division, there's flesh in the church today. Because we as Christ's church are also in ruins. We wouldn't see the conditions of degenerated generations and devastated cities and ruined truths if the church was not in ruins. My biggest battle, even in the field that God has assigned me to, is not the world. The biggest attack on my life, I wasn't called a heretic by a sinner. I'm not grieved because of what someone called me. Ask John. I can be a very detached person. Tough cookie. It's what I've gone through in life. I'm grieved because my heart feels for people who themselves are either that hardened and calloused without ever even having a conversation, or that deceived and blinded to be taking a hammer instead of building that church, tearing it down. The church is so confused, they don't know what to stand for. They don't know what is truth. Go on social media. Black church fighting the white church. White church fighting the black church. I name a pastor right now in Atlanta that says, if you are, and it's a big church, if you are black and you follow any white man, get out of their church right now. Oh, Elder, that's small compared to what I've heard. Do you think God's looking at our ethnicity? Our gender? He's looking at our heart. He's calling us back to Him. You'll know me by the love they have one for another. You'll know me by the love they have one for another. We've not only failed to mourn our situation, we haven't even grasped that we're in ruins. We just think it's still, like, life is normal. It's not normal. It will be state after state after state after state until you won't be allowed to come into almost any sanctuary. If the enemy continues, I never thought in my life I didn't think, Dr. Paul, I would see in my lifetime. It didn't really enter into my head or my heart. Forgive me, Lord, that I would see in my lifetime. And I've always been compassionate about 8 out of 10 Christians that are persecuted around the world and people of all faiths. Because people of all faiths, unless it's a radical, terrorist, destructive faith that would do damage to hurt a person, should be able to freely practice their religion, should be able to freely practice their faith. God himself said, I set before you life and death. Choose life that you and your seed may live. He didn't force you to serve him. He set out a path for you to serve him. He set out a choice when he gave you free will. But I never thought I would see where they would say, you can go protest, you can go to a casino, you can go do this, but you cannot go to the house of God. You cannot worship. You cannot have home church. And it's happening so rapidly and so fast. Like I said, the frog, by the time that the frog jumps out of the water, it will have already been boiled. Because it seems like it's fast, but it's been a long time coming. May God use his blood-bought church to restore the ruins, the ancient ruins of his truce, and the devastation of cities, and the desolation of cities and of generations. We have church. But we obviously don't have all the power of the living God abiding in his temple, abiding in his temple. Like those in captivity, we have fallen far and don't even realize it. Maybe it's a wake-up call. Maybe God is bringing us to repentance, to restore his temple, to restore his temple, to restore his temple. And while the redemption of man was always motivating Jesus, his most ardent desire and his zeal always has been and always will be for his Father's house. He was consumed with his Father's house. John 2:17, building the house of God, the born again, praying, loving citywide church has always been Christ's highest priority, because the world is his harvest, but the church is his bride. The world is his harvest for whosoever, but the church is his bride. I live in a neighborhood with about 30-something different houses. I like my neighbors. Greg, I'll go over, we'll take them something usually for Christmas. I'll borrow some baking soda if I need them. I like them, Luz, but I don't love them like I love him. I don't love them like I love my grandkids. I don't love them like I love you. Say, well, you should. I like them. I know I got some sweet neighbors. The world is his harvest, but the church is his bride. The church is who he's in covenant with. The church is who he is passionately in love with. His love for the church, and I'll be through, was the basis of his last recorded prayer, that we would be one. First words and last words of a man are the most important. Father, let them be one even as we are one. It's still his highest priority and passion today. John 17:20-23. For until we are united in him, the world will not believe that God has sent him. Jerusalem fell to Babylon. And I'm not going to dare touch eschatology. I'll leave this to the rest of them. Jerusalem fell to Babylon. Jeremiah's day for many reasons. But here is the main reason and where I'll get you to. The underlining reason was because of spiritual apostasy of religious leaders. So for everyone else who's just kind of coming into faith, just hang in there for me, with me a minute. Because now I have to go to a different level and shift to a higher gear. Lamentations verse 4, verse 12 and 13 says, the adversary and the enemy could enter the gates of Jerusalem because of the sins of her prophets and the iniquities of her priest. I'm sorry, sincerely. On behalf of every man and woman of God who compromised truth and allowed the church to get in this condition, who compromised their calling, for everyone who didn't stand up when God told them to stand up, for everyone who protected their kingdom instead of his kingdom, forgive me sincerely today, because this word has been burning in me. I'm mourning. I'm sincerely mourning. Dealing with call after call of kids killing themselves, families falling apart, people wanting more money from the government, not recognizing God's their source. People fighting whether they should go back to church or not. I can't say what I really want to feel or what I really feel like saying, because God said don't release some things. It's too harsh for some people to receive. But my heart mourns. We would not be here had the prophets and the priest not sinned and had iniquity. Our gates would not be destroyed. The city was destroyed by its enemies because the religious leadership failed to bring the people to repentance. They lost the protection of God. Our cities are in disorder because the church is in disorder. And James 3:16 says, where there is jealousy and strife, there is disorder and every evil thing. Sometimes I find myself getting mad at the evil thing. Really mad at the evil thing. But I go back and recognize that without the church coming to a place of true repentance, true heartfelt, God, I need you. We missed it and we messed up with generations. We allowed on our watch the enemy to sow tares. We did not prepare our lamp as wise virgins. Somewhere, the church missed it. When our ambitions and our objectives, and we take our eyes off the will and purpose of God, we'll have ruined truths, devastated cities, and desolated cities and devastated generations. When we become jealous of one another, competitive, multiplying the American church by division. I'm good, Gina. Consequently, thank you, the disorder of lawlessness and every evil thing we see in our society, at least in part, is rooted in the soul of a misdirected and a distracted church community and what that has cost us. And I'll tell you one of the reasons. It was so silly. And I didn't even tell you this, baby. It's so silly why I just burned with this. But it wasn't. God had me purposely do this. But when we have become so misdirected, what it has cost us is credibility. And John and I started doing something, and I'll show you what happens in Ezra 8, and I'll finish this. I'll have to stay on this track. John and I, when COVID started happening, you know, I'm not much of a movie watcher because I just probably can't sit still for long enough. Too much hyper energy in me. We started watching a movie every night. It's our nighttime. We have our little rituals and routines. So he'll cook an amazing dinner and we'll pick out a movie or something. We'll watch a movie and go to bed. Well, last night we said, Brad, why don't you come over? Rachel's got the kids in Texas. We said, come over and have dinner with us and let's watch a movie. And after all these days, we've seen about everything you can watch. That you can watch. And we got everything you can have, Hulu and Netflix and all your cable and everything you guys have. And we're all, what are we gonna watch? What are we gonna watch? What are we gonna watch? So finally, we turn on this movie. What's it called? Well, The Sloan. Is a movie about Washington and lobbyists. And I was like, okay, because I didn't feel like watching a shoot-up one. So let me just watch a crazy one of a different type of shoot-up. So I just decided to watch it. And there's a scene that her attorney, in the beginning, and it hit me like, phew. Of course, you've got liberal media, Hollywood, different thing. There's a scene. Their attorney turns around because it's a lobbyist that gets in trouble over Indonesia and everything else. It's not worth watching. But she's in that, and then now it's going to be, she's going to be this come against her thing for gun rights activist, and it's lobbying, it's the game. And there's a scene he said, he's telling her how, because she's known as the biggest, baddest lobbyist in all Washington, this character. She wins everything. All she does is live to win in her lobbying. And her attorney, who's one of the best attorneys, turns around to her and says, you know, the only thing worse than a lobbyist that has less credibility than a lobbyist is a faith healer. And you know the reality? That's exactly what the world thinks. But God gave his son to die, to be beaten, to be bruised, to have a possible 1,404 stripes upon his back, to be ripped open with arteries bleeding, and body bursted so that cancer had to leave your body, so that sugar diabetes had to go, so that you would be emotionally healed. But the credibility, even the enemy knows how supernatural and miraculous. The credibility was lost because somewhere the church has become just a mockery to the world. And Paul mourned because the church had no abiding power because they had become carnal. God, restore us. Bring us back to you. How can we expect a world to hear our message? How can we expect a world to love you? When we fail to love one another, when we fail to obey you, I won't get into it, but I'll take you there next week, because what Ezra does in Ezra chapter 7, he restores the word, but in Ezra chapter 8, he begins to list those who join to return to Jerusalem. Because who you are connected to, and I just want to take you to one point, who you are connected to determines whether you'll get there. The first order, and the reason that I went through what I went through, was the very first order are the members of the priestly and the royal house. You see it in Ezra chapter 8, verse 1 and 2. Then he follows the register and the number of the people, Ezra chapter 8, verse 3 through 14. So what was he doing? Ezra knew the structure of his society enough to directly appeal to the heads or the pastors of the families. Ezra chapter 7, verse 28, Ezra chapter 8, verse 1. Knowing that in most cases, if they came, they would bring their groups also. So he understood the Melchizedek order of focusing of leadership in church. He understood the power of headship in families and in the church. I believe in God, by your mercy and grace, you're doing the same today. Restore the order of households. Restore men in our society. Restore husbands. Restore pastors. See, I have deep convictions. I believe that God can use a woman. I believe that I believe God gave me a grace to do what I do. I came a pastor by default, because a man failed. I have a grace, and God uses women. I'm not legalistic like God doesn't use women. There's no gender in Christ. But there is certainly a different assignment for men and women. There just is. And it's very scripturally laid out. An irony of my life. May God restore us. May God restore your family. May God restore your home. May God restore our society. May God restore the pulpit. May God restore the pulpit. And may your ears never be hungry and itching ears for cotton candy. May your heart be hungry, instead of you just being like, oh my gosh, there she goes again. An hour and 20 minutes. Be in one of Paul's services. Be 24 hours, you'll fall out the window, break your neck, but he'll raise you from the dead. May your heart be hungry with so much understanding and grieved for the condition, until every brother and sister in the household of faith is restored to the ancient truths. May our devastated cities be restored, not because we just have ethnicity differences, which we don't as far as in here, but you know what movement. Not because we have lawlessness and everything, but because the church arises, and out of the love of God, the truths of ancient ruins have been restored, the truth of God's word, which brings restoration to devastated cities, desolated cities, and devastated generations. May your truth be restored to generations that have been lost, God. To generations, to our sons and daughters. May they awaken with truth, God. May they awaken with truth. May we recognize shepherds that have your heart. Word that has your oil. Your spirit that rests upon your temple. May we hook our bandwagon up to where you are. When the cloud moves, may we move with you, oh God. When the cloud stays, can we stand still? Will you give us a spirit of boldness and a grace to stand up and boldly proclaim the truth of the gospel? That I am not ashamed of the gospel and the power thereof. Lord, we repent. We repent. We repent. We repent for allowing the enemy to be so aggressive to take territory. May we take back territory. May we take back territory. May we redeem time. May we redeem places. May we redeem this nation. May we redeem our school system. May we redeem the mountains, the seven mountains. May we redeem media. May we redeem government. May we redeem these systems that are in operation. May we redeem them in the name of Jesus. Holy Spirit, do a deep work in us. Restore your church. Bring us to unity, for there is the commanded blessing. You know, if you have any ought in your heart against anyone, if there's any unforgiveness, come on up, guys. If there's anything in you, ask God to just let it go. If there's any wounding, ask God to cleanse you. If it stays there, it's like a bad infection. As I prayed over Anna today, I knew she'd come through her surgery just fine. I prayed that she'd heal quickly, that there'd be no infection. It's infection, Elder, in the blood that kills us, right? I know. It's infection that gets in our blood. Any infection in you, I'm talking to you spiritually, emotionally, may be cleansed right now by the Spirit of God. Everyone gets hurt. Everyone gets betrayed. Everyone gets disappointed. It's part of this thing called life. But not everyone has to stay stuck there. Let it go. Let it go. Let go of any legalism. Let go of any wounding. Let go of any hurt. Shame. Guilt. Let go of anything holding you to your past. May the blood of Jesus in the body as we begin to take it purge you. Sorry for going long, but I've had a word in my spirit. May you mourn over the church until you see the unity. Mr. Greg Twana, come on.
Praise the Lord. Let's just stay in that vein of repentance as we begin to observe the Lord's body. Everyone, just put your mind on Jesus Christ right now. Like Pastor was saying, if you have any ought in your heart against anybody, any offense, somebody's done you wrong or failed to live up to your expectations, and maybe you're upset with them or something happened, you could legitimately have a right to be mad at them, and you've held on to it. just release it right now. The Bible says even before we bring our offering to the Lord, we should go and ask forgiveness of someone who's offended us and then bring our offering. So it's showing that God really cares about the matters of our heart more than money. If you're not saved as well, just ask the Lord Jesus to come into your heart. Just repent. Just tell God you're sorry for your sins. It's something that we all have to do daily because we're human. We live in a fallen world. We have a real live enemy, and we have our own sinful nature that we have to contend with on a daily basis. And so, Lord Jesus, we ask you, Father God, just to look upon this service, look upon this moment as we observe your body. Look upon us with compassion. We repent. We ask you to forgive us as a body of believers. Even though you've saved us, sometimes we've compromised. Sometimes we have not done everything that you've asked us to do. Sometimes we've even been slowful. Sometimes we've been forgetful. Sometimes we've missed the mark deliberately. So we ask you to forgive us. We repent and we turn our hearts. We set our face towards you. In John 6, 53 through 58, Jesus said to them, "Truly, I tell you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise them up at the last day. For my flesh is real food and my blood is real drink. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood remains in me and I in them. Just as the living Father sent me and I live because of the Father, so the one who feeds on me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven. Your ancestors ate manna and died, but whoever feeds on this bread will live forever." So let's take of the wafer together, which represents the body of Christ. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your sacrifice. We thank you that you gave your life that we can have a relationship with Father God again, that our sins will be forever blotted out, placed as far from us as the east is to the west, Lord God. We thank you for a new covenant with better promises. We thank you for the promise of the Holy Spirit, which is a deposit for what we will receive in eternity. In Jesus' name, let's partake together.
And now we will prepare to take of the blood of Christ. In Galatians 2:20, it says, "I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me." So Christ gave himself for us. And right now, we prepare to take of his blood. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 25 says, "In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This is the cup. This is the new covenant in my blood. Do this in remembrance of me.'" And so, Father, we just thank you for the new covenant that we have with you, Father, through the blood of Jesus. We just, Father God, receive the new covenant and all of the blessings and benefits that come with that covenant. We've submitted our hearts to you, God. We need you. We love you. Partake of the blood of Christ now. Receive your healing. Receive your deliverance. Receive your new relationship, your new perspective, your new goal in Christ. Receive it and walk by faith and not by sight. We receive the blood of Jesus now. Thank you for your blood, Jesus. Begin to celebrate and thank God. Amen. And prepare for prayer.
Amen. Amen.
Glory to God. Hallelujah. Let us stand and pray together to God today. Glory to God. And I want to pray Daniel 11:32 over all of us today. It says, "But those who know their God will be strong and do great exploits."
Amen.
So Lord, I come right now, Father God, that in the spirit you may strengthen each and every one of us, Lord God, as we begin to do great exploits for you, Father. Let us be strong to be able to love, Lord God. Let us be strong to be able to forgive. Let us be strong to be able to unite. Let us be strong to be able to come again against any spirit of the Antichrist that might show up anywhere in our lives, in our families, in our communities. Let us be strong to take back what the enemy has taken from us, and that we are going to gain ground this week, starting right now,
Amen.
Starting today. We
Amen.
Are strong, church. You are strong, church. And together we can, and together we will, in Jesus' mighty name. Amen and amen. Hallelujah and praise be to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you. Glory to God. Hallelujah. And guys, we shall see you on Wednesday. Don't forget that on Wednesday we have our online service at 7 p.m. So please join us, share us in all your social media as well, and invite someone for next service next Sunday. Just spread the word out. We really do appreciate that. And now we'll see our benediction, Ephesians 3:20. Let me see if I got this in my mind now.
Now
unto him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we can ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us. Have a great week, guys. Thank you for coming out. We love you.
Love you all.